Welcome to another weekend episode in Talk with Sanjana. So guys, today we are going to talk about a different industry. So far we have tried to cover most of the industries that in and around us, but today we are going to talk about event planning. So from this, what I understand is as an event planner, you need to have good networking skills, good conversational and good organization skills. But today we are trying to know more about the industry. So here I am in conversation with CEO and founder of Tharini Weddings. Let me introduce Soumya Raghu. Hi Soumya, welcome to the show.
How are you?
I'm doing good. How are you doing, Soumya?
Doing great. Thank you.
Great. So, Soumya, like I said, we are, you know, today here talking about events and trying to know more about the industry. But before everything, let me get started with you. First of all, during this pandemic, what are you doing and how are you trying to make best use of this time? Could you want to tell something on this?
Sure. I think, as we all know, the wedding industry, the event industry is quite badly hit by the pandemic. So, during the pandemic, of course, it's brought like the event industry to almost like a standstill, right? But it's understandable. It's been affecting all aspects of our life. And weddings being social gatherings, you know, it's but natural that people tend to mingle closely, even often forgetting social distancing norms. So the current government norms include, the guidelines include 50 pax weddings only. Right. And our guess is that's here to stay. So yeah, but what we've been doing is some of our events from April and May were rescheduled to June. So we worked only on these rescheduled events as we wanted to, you know, kind of like honor our commitments made to these couples. Mm-hmm. However, as the pandemic is spreading rapidly, and of course, the safety of our team is prime importance. Hence, right now, we're all like, you know, just like working from home and concentrating on like upskilling, getting ready with new designs and working hand in hand with other upcoming weddings from November to February mainly. So, yeah.
Right.
Now, I guess it's important to stay safe.
Absolutely. So I would definitely get more towards the kind of trends and how do you adapt to the trends in this industry. But before we get into that, I would like to know what are the services that Tharini Wedding offers?
So we are primarily a wedding decor design company and have moved into wedding planning exclusively as well. So basically we can help you plan the entire wedding, you know, put you in touch with all the vendors for various services that you might require, all the while actually like planning the actual look and feel of your decor in great detail. So we have an in-house design and production team and a planning team as well.
Okay, so let's suppose say that you have a requirement that comes up. So as an event planner, what is the first most step that goes into place? What is the first step that goes into place when you get a requirement from the customers?
So our preliminary meeting is crucial with, we meet brides, grooms, and their families. Some of our initial meetings have even had up to like 25, 30 people. Mm-hmm. And sometimes, of course, these are virtual meets also when we're, you know, dealing with like NRI clientele. Yes. So we take in all their inputs, their event lineup, the list of requirements, the budget, and we also explain our services to them. Step two is to like put all of this together in a very cohesive manner and prepare proposals that are, both in terms of the look and the overall spread of items that they require. So obviously no two weddings are the same. So we've seen very intimate weddings, very intimate gatherings to, you know, the big fat Indian weddings. So we have to kind of put it all together to kind of, you know, so that people are able to visualize what all they're looking at of sorts. And then there is, of course, the meeting at the venue, a detailed discussion of the budget and finalization of requirements. And this can take anywhere from 3 to 8 meetings, depending on the size of the wedding itself.
Right. So when we are looking at the skill set of this, so someone to get into event planning, there could be a lot of courses and everything. But do you believe that it's also important to have inbuilt skill set, like maybe a leadership quality or taking accountability? All these things mm-hmm. are really important, especially in Indian wedding, because these are like we do have a lot of like big pack weddings, right, with too many people around. So the responsibility increases with the number of people as well. So when you are hiring someone, or when we talk about the skill set, what are the important aspects that one needs to consider when we are in an event industry?
Right. So like you rightly mentioned, Sanjana, the biggest thing is accountability, because somebody is trusting you with their wedding, and there is no second chance. Whatever you do, it's a memory that they carry for a lifetime. So the responsibility on each of us is extremely high to make sure that nothing goes amiss on that day. So as a team, generally what we're looking for when we hire people into our team is definitely there are different roles in the wedding planning team itself. But basically, we just need everybody to have a great sense of organizational skills and prioritization, time management, and a lot of attention to detail. So these are by default something that everybody, no matter what role they're playing in the event team, they need to be kind of equipped with. Just general common sense, being warmth, having a genuine interest in people, being able to keep a very calm mind frame. Those are also very important qualities, right, as an event planner, because you're really under high stress situations at different points in time. So,
right. Yeah. So when we're talking about the trends, this trend keeps changing. There is something or the other. It could be in terms of the color choices. Now we have a lot of like subtle colors. There was a time we were only looking for like bright colors, or that also is reflecting into the bridal costumes as well. Now everybody are moving towards subtle colors. So something like that, when we are looking at the trends that we have today, how do you keep up with the new trends? And is there another set of, I would say, a team who's taking care of these ideas, or how do you manage these?
So we love to be trendsetters ourselves, but being a design house, we're always looking for inspiration and most often our biggest source is our clients, right? Their personal preferences play a huge role in our design and the kind of decor that can be done out of that. But from the industry, definitely we love observing trends in the fashion industry, as that's very closely associated with ours. And there is a lot of, there are a lot of other weddings that generally, you're looking at the venues, the kind of space the ambience has, and you're always keeping an eye out for new things in the market. And that definitely plays a part in the overall design aspect of a wedding. And to also answer, a lot of brainstorming, a lot of idea generation happens in-house by the same team that designs the weddings.
Right. So when we look at an event, sometimes there could be a situation when things may not go as planned, right? Mm-hmm. So how do you give us some examples of any of such incidents where it didn't go as it was supposedly has to be in place? So is there anything mm-hmm. that you would like to tell on that?
Most often, I think what doesn't go as planned, especially in the Indian scenario, is the timing of the whole thing, right? So we've seen weddings where all the guests have turned up and there are they're just waiting, and the bride or the groom are still not ready yet, or they're just delayed because another event that was there before that went on too long. So with Indian weddings, we have a lot of customs
in Indian weddings, right?
Yeah, and sometimes it's very hard to just say let's stop now and move to something else. Let's now break for lunch because then we have only 2 hours to get ready. So that kind of spills over, and there's like a time lag that you're running through, which is, I think, quite often that we see in Indian weddings generally. But that is the only way, of course, is to also make sure that there are entertainment options kept ready for guests so that they're not bored during the time that they're waiting for this to happen. or to also have like second point of contact from the family who could, you know, probably give the approval for us to say open the buffet or something like that. So in the meanwhile, guests can, you know, maybe quickly grab dinner and come back, and then the couple's up there on the stage, and you know, nobody's really inconvenienced.
Right. So now talking about the industry that you are already into, what made you get into event planning? Was this something you are always a priority, always, or you were always into the event planning and leadership and on all of this right from the beginning? What is your side of the story?
So I am actually a science student. I've studied economics, math, statistics, and born and brought up in Bangalore. Mm-hmm. I did always I did always want to, you know, lead a team, or you know, kind of want to take up like managerial roles. I was really interested in doing an MBA, and I worked for a corporate firm, Ernst & Young, for a couple of years before I moved into the event industry. Even in events, I tried like different genres of events, like fashion events and corporate events, before I moved into weddings.
So was this attached to a company, or it was again on your own?
No, this was on my own. I was freelancing with different companies. I even interned at a couple of different companies. But when I did move into when I joined a wedding planning firm, it kind of, you know, really changed the whole game for me, because the weddings are a very different ball game. If you have the knack for it, you can really do. You don't really need to particularly, you know, kind of have already studied something. It does help, of course, if you have a background and you've studied something in the field. But it's basically about how you, you know, kind of swim in it and how well you're equipped with things. So that's what I think. The moment I got into weddings, I knew this was it for me. And yeah, it's been almost 7 years now, and it's been a great journey.
Great, good to hear that. So, so someone to start as a event planner, what do you suggest him? What should be that starting point, and how he should build on top of it? He or she should build on top of it.
Yeah. So, look, your preliminary education could be anything, right? You could have a graduate degree, but I do strongly recommend that, especially now, that you do a small course, a certificate course in events, or even do like a 6 month, 1 year course in event management. It really kind of tunes your mind into getting into events. And events are a lot of commitment, you know. They really eat into your personal time. They really eat into your social life. And that is something we're not really prepared until we enter the field, right? There is only an entry time. There's pretty much no exit time. And these are things that we do not realize. It looks really fancy and glamorous from the outside. Oh, it's all these weddings. And, you know, we've seen our band Baja Barat. And we're like, oh, we're imagining ourselves dancing at every other wedding and eating a lot of wedding food. But trust me, the reality on ground is very, very different. You're so tired at the end of a wedding, you just want a bed. I mean, forget the food. So, yeah. So these are things that you need to really kind of get prepared for. And that means my biggest suggestion is definitely to do internships at different companies. Preferably even do like work full time for a company for a couple of years before you venture out on your own to get into, get into this full time as your own business problem.
Right. So talking about, let's say, your first client, how did you receive one?
The first client was a reference, actually. It came from a referral, somebody I knew. They were looking for somebody to do the decor. I had just, I'd moved out from my previous company where I was working as a wedding planner, and I'd been doing solo, flying solo for about, I think, 6 months or so before this came by. And this was like a full-blown wedding. They wanted us to do a three-event wedding back in 2014. So I put out my resources, sat, you know, kind of planned the whole thing. Didn't have really an office space, nothing. But it was nice. We managed to put everything together. I hired a lot of vendors to get things in place because I didn't have my own inventory. And it was a huge success. And from there on, I started getting referrals. And I think the initial 5 to 6 months went that way until we, you know, kind of built ourselves as a brand and, you know, started getting leads more, organically, apart from references as well.
Right. So today in this pandemic, this is a question I think most of us would want to know. You know, we know that there is a pack of 50 people who are supposedly come and attend a wedding, and that's how it is. And most probably when things get better, we might see an increase in numbers. But now with this set of people, still, you know, weddings are like the best memory of anyone in their lives, right? They want it to be special. Maybe it's 50 or even 15 set of people. So that's with that, how would you, you know, accomplish the goal of a bride and groom if it's a pack of very small people wedding?
So the advantage, if I have to talk about these micro weddings, right, I find that the couples find it much less daunting to have just close friends and family. And I think a lot of us have always wanted smaller weddings with closer people, in a way, not necessarily inviting a friend's friend's daughter or somebody just for courtesy's sake. So it's really given couples that chance to celebrate with the ones they really like. And I've seen that the overall quality of the weddings has come up because generally people now have a wider bandwidth. They want to concentrate on giving a much better experience, a much safer experience to the ones that are coming in to these small weddings, right? So the decor is a lot more detailed. I think we had a lot of fun in designing both the weddings that we did in June. I would love to share some pictures with you. So sure. They're very intimate celebrations, but they've done really well, you know, very elegant set designs and a lot of smaller elements. The couple felt comfortable wanting to, you know, show pictures of, you know, of their last few years together or things like that. And it really made it so much more personal and intimate and very, very pleasant, actually. It was very nice. So they're enjoying it, I would say.
Right. I mean, that usually happens in Indian weddings. You are supposedly have to call each and every person, like you can't ignore, right? And that's when elderly people would come up and say, you can't leave him or that. And this is what happens in every family, I would say, every Indian family, right? So with this, I think we have had a lot of information about the event planning industry and how things run around this industry. But is there anything, just before this, you know, closing this, is there anything you would like to tell us, Soumya?
No, I think, I don't know. For me personally, I think wedding planning has been like a calling. It's a career path that I've taken very seriously, despite all, you know, though it's all, there's a lot of fun in it. And for everyone out there who's considering events and getting into weddings, it's a beautiful experience. You must, I think just give it a shot and I'm sure it'll be fun.
Right. Until it's like, basically, I think it's a flow that you need to catch, because in the beginning, it might be a little bit of hardships in order to get good leads or at least one or two leads. Right. Then once it goes on,
You meet a lot of people, right? You're meeting people across different walks of life. On the same day, you're talking to vendors, you're meeting your clients, you're probably entering a 5-star hotel and designing the whole layout. So there is just like the entire bisection of the community that you really are going to meet. And it develops you as a person because you understand where people are coming from. And that, I think, is the biggest takeaway. And no 2 days are the same for me. That's the biggest joy, because no 2 days of my routine are ever the same. I do not have the same thing going on any 2 days, and that itself is the biggest job satisfaction that I get, right, personally.
And I think that definitely comes from the kind of customers you have. You may not have the same customer requirement every time, right? It keeps changing.
No two weddings are the same.
Yep. Right. Great, Soumya. It was wonderful having this chat with you. I think we have been trying from very long time. Finally, we were able to make it. And and so what I would like to say is, at the end, thanks for all the information. I hope this is going to be useful for the people who are trying to get into the industry and trying to do something on their own. And I hope once this pandemic, everything comes down, we will see more weddings. I think all of us are just eagerly waiting to get ready and go out. I hope this happens very soon, and just hoping for the best. And just want to say, take care, stay safe and stay healthy. And take care of your family and yourself as well.
Thank you so much. Lovely talking to you, Sanjana.
Same here, Soumya. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.